Welcome to Side by Side, a podcast where I, Robert Kwong, take you inside conversations with artists, creatives, healers, and warriors taking the charge in their transformational story. Today's guest is Vanessa Esparza, a leadership coach and partner at Gladstone Place Partners, overseeing the people and administration. In this conversation, we explore her roots as a first-generation Mexican-American, her passion for service, and the importance of empathy and presence in collaboration and talent retention. You can find more side-by-side conversations at sidebysidepodcast.podbean.com. And if you'd like to connect with me about my services, including my upcoming writing workshop, please visit www.robertkwonhome.com. So I'm really excited to be connecting with Vanessa again, and a little bit about how we met. We met through like a group training facilitation experience that was really focused on like energy maintenance, empathy, and leading with compassion. And then we just sort of like, you know, kept following up with each other after that. So, but yeah, it's so nice to be seeing you again. How are you doing today, Vanessa?
Thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited to be here with you and to be in conversation. I am doing very well. I'm just really excited to have this chat with you.
Yeah, I really love diving into people's like origin stories, like I like to say. So one thing that I know we have in common is we both grew up in Colorado, which is like pretty nice. And in fact, we have a little bit of a overlap in our journey. We both grew up in Colorado and then moved to New York City to continue our higher education, basically. Mm-hmm. So I would love to hear a little bit about what was growing up in Colorado like and what made you decide to go to the other side of the country.
Yeah, well, so I think a little bit about me. I identify as a Mexican woman. I am first generation, born in the States, and then also first generation to go to college and do sort of all of those things. My family, for the most part, is now in Colorado. I have some family in Mexico still, but most everyone moved to Colorado, you know, in the 80s and 90s. And so I grew up in a Mexican household where I would say, you know, Spanish was my first language. And so it was like really interesting because growing up, like speaking only Spanish until probably 4 or 5, and then sort of going into school and having to learn English, but then forgetting Spanish. Yeah. It was just, there are some clear memories I have, but ultimately I would say it was a really positive experience. I mean, I had a close-knit family and still do, you know, I was able to go to like Denver Public Schools and, ended up going to the University of Colorado at Denver.
Oh yeah. I forgot. Same. Right.
I know there was that piece. I think what I would say was really interesting is that I didn't, like many people, didn't fully appreciate everything that Denver and Colorado had to offer until I was gone. And so looking back, I guess looking back now, I can think of it, you know, quite fondly, just being able to play outside. And I was pretty active as a kid. And so being able just to have that access to a front yard and backyard, which is obviously just very different from New York, and the mountains, I would say, moving to New York City gave me a newfound appreciation of everything that I had in my backyard in Colorado.
I know. We were talking about this before, but it's like I go home at when you're sort of like, I need a break from the city, quote unquote, very common thing to hear. And then I go to Colorado, and after a few weeks, I was like, it's so quiet. Like you kind of yearn for that level of quiet and peace when you're in the city. And then when I'm there, I'm like, oh my gosh, I have so much quiet and peace. So there must be some part of me that's always looking for, you know, that contrast or something like that. But I too had the same experience of, wow, like I didn't appreciate my backyard when I was in Colorado. I should have a little bit more.
Yeah, well, it's also one of those things that I think, and we'll probably get into this a bit more in a conversation, but just like the importance of nature, and I would say the importance of, at least for me now, right? Like in terms of, just what do I do to source myself in a city that, well, I love New York City. It is just very energetic. And lively, right? And that is so great in so many ways. And in other ways can just be, at least for me, a bit overwhelming because there's just like a natural sort of activation of always having to be on in the city. So getting that space, getting to be out in nature, getting sort of that quiet, like where you see the stars and it's pitch dark and is now something that for me is just a necessity to be able to source myself.
I love the little upstate trips and stuff like that because sometimes you really need that. And thinking about growing up, that must have been an interesting experience to like grow up in one language. And then was it pretty natural for you to become bilingual, or was it sort of like, wow, the outside world is speaking in a different language than how I do at home? And like, and it's also you were so young, so I don't even know if you would remember some of that, but do you remember any of those early language experiences?
So I have two very vivid memories, and one is of being a kid. I want to say maybe I was going into preschool and going into class and being surrounded by English speakers and just like not having any idea what was being said. And I remember feeling very I mean just very like confused, a bit of an outsider. I don't recall sort of what happened from there forward, but then call it a year later, maybe a little bit longer, I remember being in Mexico with family, and I had cousins that were all my age and having a similar experience but with Spanish, and it's like I could understand them, but I couldn't speak it. And so these are two very vivid memories that I have of just like what that experience was like. I don't really think I noticed. I mean, what my family spoke Spanish, so I didn't understand or know that there was a different way of sort of doing things or being, right? At least that I can recall, except when I started that first day of school and then visiting family in Mexico and being like, oh, I don't know what these people are saying.
Yeah, those early memories, they're from so long ago that I don't even think about them. But then as you're speaking, I'm thinking about like for a number of years, all the way through middle school, it was like my legal name was still my Mandarin Chinese name. And so every time they would do the roll call, they would struggle to say the name because it was just phonetically Chinese. And then I would be like, oh, I go by Robert until my name was legally changed. And so it was like every start of class, I knew what was coming. You know, it's just going to be an awkward of like struggling to pronounce my name. And then I have to say, like, I go by Robert. And people are like, where did that come from? Where did Robert come from? But whatever. But it was like Groundhog's Day, you know, just that over and over again until, you know, my legal name was changed. Yeah, I love hearing these early experiences because you don't really realize the implications of these experiences all the time, you know, at least for me as a kid, of what that might have meant for me in that classroom. You know, like we were too young to think about these things.
Yeah, no, definitely. Well, it also has me think about just like the importance of language and exposure to, to different cultures. And I in Colorado felt I never that I can recall, I never felt like I was sort of out of place. We had our community and we had our family, and so there was a very strong like Mexican American community. So I always felt pretty comfortable. But even thinking back on just like the importance of exposure to different foods and different cultures and different languages and how impactful that is from a very young age.
Absolutely. Do you remember? Because I know you studied human capital management, I think it's called. Is it kind of related to human resources, or is that too simplified?
No, that would be a good way to describe it. I think over the last 10 years, there's been a shift from like resources to capital, but
Gotcha.
it's all, sort of people-focused talent management.
I'm curious, would be like, I'd be curious about what you wanted to be or do growing up, even though we were so young, right? And ultimately, what made you decide to study areas like human capital management and like political science, I think is the other one. Yeah.
Yeah, so my undergrad was in political science. I thought I wanted to be a lawyer, and I actually thought I wanted to go into public interest law. I had an experience in Colorado, while I was still in school, where I volunteered as a court-appointed special advocate. It's CASA is a nonprofit organization with chapters throughout the country, and so that experience for me in working with a family with two small children who had been removed from the home and at the time had been in foster care. So I was going to attend all of their hearings and ultimately was able to write a report so that there could be reunification with the children's family. But all that to say that had me really be interested in sort of law as it pertained to children. And so I thought I wanted to do that for a while. I worked in law as a paralegal for a handful of years. And then I actually changed my mind, decided law wasn't sort of for me. What I love and I think I'm really grateful for now is that my career has not been linear by sort of any stretch of the word. I've always pursued things that just interest me. That's not usually the advice that people are given as it relates to their career paths, but that
Yeah.
has given me a range of experiences. And so I eventually came to human capital management because I realized my interest in sort of supporting employees and people with their development, personal professional development. And so from there, did my master's in human capital management. While I was in grad school, I took a couple of coaching classes for my degree. And then that sort of led me to the more formalized coach training program, and then ultimately where you and I met. But it really is, I think, something that has been interesting to me is just sort of being of service and supporting people as they are thinking through various stages of their development.
Yeah, I can hear the kind of the theme, you know what I mean? There is sort of a thread that I hear you following in different ways and maybe in different career paths. Now you are a partner at your work and everything, working as with the people, with the team, which is what you wanted to do. So it kind of makes sense despite all of the turns and the surprises, right?
I mean, definitely. In my role as a partner, I lead the people and administration for a financial communications firm called Gladstone Place Partners. And then I also separately work with clients as it relates to they are individuals who are very heart-centered and want to lead very intentionally. And so that could be launching a company, or it could be, working through and wanting to build community in a new area. But the intentionality, and I think that sort of heart-centeredness is what has been sort of common amongst clients I've worked with.
Well, and people, listeners might be surprised hearing, a workplace like a financial firm, financial communications firm, that the word like empathy and being heart-centered would even appear at all. Even though I know there's been like kind of a revolution around that, but I think people are still like, that's mostly lip service, right? Like it's just going to be on the page, but it's not going to be put into practice. I've definitely heard a lot of those sentiments, but this is a, like just knowing you a little bit, this is an area that you really care about and you think is an important skill and value to uphold within a business. So can you just talk about why that's so important for you specifically?
I think that what I, when I say heart-centered, and what I think about is, as human beings, we have emotions, and you know, while many people may not want to admit that, I think it's Brené Brown. She says, you know, we're actually emotional beings that think, not, you know, people that think who just also have emotions. And so being aware of those emotions, I think, is just something that's hugely important and certainly has served me well in my life and in my career. When I think about empathy and I think about just being heart-centered, it's about that intentionality. It's about, you know, I would assert that an emotional, you know, being emotion-led and being heart-centered are very similar. There's a deep caring, whether it be about people or, you know, the work that is being done. The intentionality piece is what I think, combined with being heart-centered, really leads to leadership that makes, you know, positive impact. At the end of the day, you know, being able to lead ourselves, being able to lead our teams, being able to lead across clients, it requires an awareness and a self-awareness that I think is just hugely valuable. And so not only having that self-awareness, but then being able to extend it to colleagues and team members and clients, et cetera, through empathy and through compassion and through active listening and genuine care. You know, it's surprising how far something like that can go in relationship building when there's just, you know, genuine care of like, I don't know, how was your mother? I remember, you know, she had surgery recently, or, you know, little things like that really make such a big impact on the relationship. It's not just about the bottom line. I think it adds to it.
Yeah.
But there's a human aspect to it.
And, you know, generally based on your work experience, professional experience and training, what are some of the consequences when there's a deficit or a neglect of things like being heart-centered in your approach to collaboration or working with people? And also just when there's a deficit in the leadership overall, like what are some consequences of that?
Yeah, I mean, overall, certainly like retention and talent management. I mean, it's really hard to keep people on a team and keep them motivated if A, they don't feel like you care, or if they know that you care, but ultimately the impact is just detrimental. You know, there are people who unfortunately aren't able to manage their emotions well and can be quite reactive. And that happens to all of us. We're human. You know, it's not to call them out specifically, but as leaders, it's really important to model the behavior that we want our colleagues to display and how we want them to behave. And so if we have a leader that is, you know, maybe a bit too short with people, or that just doesn't demonstrate that genuine care, people will start to not be motivated. You know, they'll start to question, and ultimately that impacts, you know, it impacts retention, it impacts a company's ability to service its clients or to sell its products. That is, I mean, ultimately it's just detrimental.
Yeah, I think it can be hard to pinpoint and like describe these things as like real tangible measures that you need to be looking at the same way as you would with numbers and figures. But like, I've seen some real consequences. I mean, companies, entire companies have been, you know, dissolved because people are not able to work together very well. I can't help but think about like empathy and being heart-centered as like, yes, you can definitely have to manage your emotions. It would be good to have some like fluency and maybe have some experience in knowing yourself a little bit with that. And we do with like in coaching and everything. But I've also seen the exact opposite when there's like a deficit of emotions where like, it's not that people aren't hardworking and intelligent, but it's like no one's emotionally available to care. Does that make sense? This is a dating term, but it's almost like you can tell it's like, it's not that you can't physically or mentally follow through or complete the project, but no one really is emotionally caring. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does make sense. It makes me think of in just our day to day. I mean, we do this all the time where it's like, oh, how are you? Good. But like before you've answered, they're already, you know, they're like already a block away.
That wasn't a real concern. Yeah.
So it makes me think of that a little bit, you know, of just like not truly being connected and present, which you know, if I'm imagine we were like talking to coaching clients, and as they're, you know, answering, we're like on our cell phones. I mean, that, how, you know, we could ask the most impactful question, but if we or they aren't sort of present, right, then it's just a block. There's no opportunity for deeper connection beyond the, you know, okay, yeah, I'm good. And then we sort of go about the day.
Yeah, clients can tell when you're answering an email during a session, you know, even if they can't see what you're looking at, people can tell. So,
oh, totally.
It's like little things do matter. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and I think that makes me think about also just the importance of being present, which I know is hard in our culture and society, because we're expected to multitask and be able to do, you know, 15 things at once and be able to also do them really well at once. And that's just not actually how we're hardwired as humans. And I think, you know, I think it's becoming clear that, yeah, multitasking is, it's not really good. It's quite impossible to do. And in fact, it makes us less productive because it takes us so much time to, if we're like in the zone on something and we get distracted, it takes, I don't know, like 20 minutes or something to get back into it. And so then you've just lost some time. But broadly thinking about just the importance of being present with the people that we're with and, you know, with our colleagues and with our clients, et cetera, to, even if it's for a split second, you know, just to sort of demonstrate like, okay, we have that moment of connection and just like ability to really build that trust, which I think then goes further into, you know, relationships and even from a people like human capital perspective, how willing are they as a, as an employee going to be to stay after hours and to, you know, work on the weekends if they have to for a client and, you know, sort of go beyond and above so that you can meet the deadline when they know that, you know, they're on a team that has their back and that just generally cares.
I love that because that also spans beyond just like any one conversation. It's something that's going to take time and build over multiple interactions, multiple connections. And sometimes I think, you know, because we're kind of looking at things one conversation, 1 hour at a time, I forget of just like, but there's a lot more expansiveness and a lot more possibility in the future, even if like this one conversation didn't maybe quite go as well and things like that. And I know for you, you probably do have to lead uncomfortable conversations quite a bit here and there. Mm-hmm. What is your, do you have any insights or advice around navigating what is ultimately an uncomfortable conversation, no matter how you spin it?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, uncomfortable conversations. Yeah. I wish we could avoid them in life, but unfortunately we cannot. One of the things that I've thought about as it relates to, you know, uncomfortable or challenging conversations is also how they can be points for connection. And I mean, from my perspective, one of the things that I try to lean into is, and this is also something that you don't really hear in corporate settings very often, but like leading with love from that perspective and like understanding that the other person is a human and, you know, has these emotions, and to listen and understand their perspective, even if at the end of the day, you know, we're seeing things differently, like their experience is still valid. And the reality is that is what their reality is. Their perspective is what informs their reality. And so just being mindful, I think of that and just trying to be compassionate. And, you know, they are not always going to be pretty, but at the end of the day, like being able to leave a conversation and feel good that at least I tried to do something, or I had to have a tough conversation that I could, you know, feel good about as much as possible.
Yeah. It certainly can affect what the next conversation you two have will be, or maybe no conversation at all. You never know, but sometimes I do think about like, think of the long term, think of the bigger picture rather than just like the outcome of this one conversation, because even if it's going to be uncomfortable now, maybe it can, we can navigate it together in a way so that the next time we connect, there can be sort of like a resolution or like a shift, you know, we can sort of turn a new page. But I do think that kind of has to do with the awareness of like how to get through an uncomfortable conversation now, you know, mm-hmm. and being present to that and not try to avoid it at all cost, you know, especially in a corporate setting.
Yeah. I mean, it's hard to avoid. It's like, we can avoid things. I mean, in any setting, but
yeah.
at the end of the day, it's just a delay tactic, right? Like, for the most part, things that come to the surface need to be talked about. And I think then going to the work that we did around energy and, you know, ultimately, like, we can avoid things and just sort of bottle it up, but then we're just carrying it with us. And mm-hmm. that needs to be released somehow. Otherwise, it can really, I think, impact just well-being and the way that we show up in the world.
How do you take care of your energy and overall health? Especially, you know, things that maybe really were useful in like coaching or your training and work experience too.
Yeah, I would say I have a pretty steady meditation practice, which I think really helps. But beyond that, you know, I've just gotten to really understand the places and things and people that source me. And so going upstate and, you know, taking a walk in nature. Yeah, even going for a walk here in Central Park. I mean, it's so beautiful. But really understanding what that does for me and being intentional about, you know, I have certain friends that just being in their presence for a short while just like really energizes me. And so, you know, making it a point to see them, making it a point to, I think, just do the things that I love. I love to explore and to try new foods. And so, you know, being really intentional about things like that. And then just like quiet time. But a lot of that has to get packed in. I mean, this month, for example, it's turned out to be a really busy month. And so now I'm like, okay, I have, you know, events 3 or 4 days a week. So what are the days and where are even just the windows where I can, give myself some space to reflect and maybe read a book or, you know, and not be so on. Mm-hmm. And then trying to get some sleep. I used to think sleep was overrated. And now I'm just like, I need my sleep.
So you were that person in grad school. Got
oh,
it.
Oh, yeah. Totally. Totally. I mean, I moved to New York and it's like, of course, there's so much to do.
Yeah.
But now there's nothing like a good sleep or a good power nap.
Yeah, sadly, I'm still figuring this out myself. My body has it's still settled in a corporate time clock. So I wake up bright and early no matter what. You know, I kind of have this like, oh, I'm going to end my day around a certain time of the day. As a writer, sometimes you have creativity burst at like really late at night. Like this has just been an experience I've had along with other people. And like, I've had days where it's like, you either take it, you know, right now, even though it's 10:30 to work on this like slide deck, or, you know, maybe you should choose, you know, sleep. And those are some real choices I've had to make around that, because genuinely a lot of people are night owls, but also maybe your life does ask you to have some balance with that too, you know?
That's no, definitely. So how do you, in those moments, how do you decide? Like what guides your decision?
Well, the inspiration burst happened to me recently around that. So I can tell you what worked recently, which is I did give myself permission on like a Friday night at 10:30. I had some idea that I had to put down on a slide deck that I'm working on for this upcoming writing workshop. And I did give myself permission only because I knew that I was going to be obsessing over it mentally and that working on it then was actually not going to cost me that much energy. I was just kind of in flow because my mind was naturally just thinking about some concept or another. I chose that because I didn't feel like I was having to like really make myself do it. That's not where it came from. So like, inspiration can feel really nice if you're like, it's just going to naturally, like you're just going to be obsessed about it for the next hour anyway. And if that's the case, it's not going to take you much effort to just write it down or something, right?
Things like that. No, that makes a lot of sense.
I've had to really practice discernment with that, you know, am I really like, you know, is it really going to be kind of natural or am I kind of making myself do something here? And it's a Friday night, you know, that's different.
Well, and to that point, I recently had this experience of like tapping into what my no feels like and then tapping into what a yes feels like.
Yeah.
And what was really cool about that was, you know, I could feel what a yes was like. It was, you know, pretty easeful, pretty peaceful. And what I tapped into in terms of the no was less about the no, and it was more about a forced yes. And that was really hard. I could feel it in my body. I could, you know, it was a struggle. And so just being able to think about like in those moments, is it a yes or is it a forced yes or, you know, and like tapping into how it feels energetically, because yeah, it's 10:30 at night and you have the energy and it's not. So then it's a yes and you feel light in your body. But if it's like that struggle, and so maybe in that case, if you had not done it, but then you were sort of just obsessing about it, then that's like a forced, you know, it's a forced answer because then you're just like stuck with the energy.
Yeah.
And how that can inform us in just in general when we're thinking about things in our lives and work.
Yeah, I think that's been kind of a practice of tuning into my energy, be like, how do I really feel? Like no BS, which honestly is a challenge when it's you against yourself. Mm-hmm. And in that moment, what happened was I just worked on a couple slides and then I could stop thinking about it. Like I could go to bed for the night, you know, and that really, but I've had other times where I didn't reach for Canva. And that also has a, you know, and then I'm like on my phone for the rest of the night or kind of restless or whatever, trying to distract myself from this thought. Right. And that kind of thing. So in that sense, I also think about like something that we've talked about, which is the topic of acknowledging our ancestors and where we come from, especially for immigrant families and for people who come from indigenous cultures and things like that. This can be a topic that can be really empowering, but maybe it could also bring up a lot of interesting things. So just knowing some of the things that we've talked about, how do you integrate like your sense of like where you come from Mexico and your lineage and this life with the life you're living now?
It is something that I've been, you know, I've thought about over the years. I don't know if it was out of rebellion or just like actual, you know, intentionality, but I think I've done things differently. Like I've sort of been the first to do things. And on the one hand, I have felt the weight of that. And I think I feel the weight of that more now that I'm, you know, a bit older. But whether it be, you know, first generation in the US or, you know, first to go to college, but also thinking about moving to New York, like I left my family in Colorado. I have one other family member who, you know, at any point left Denver. And then a cousin of mine, he and his wife were living in Texas for a little while, but they've since returned. But like, that's just sort of not what you did. You know, I did it because I wanted to explore and I wanted to just sort of feel what it was like to be in a big city like this. But I do, you know, I do feel the weight of being the first. And it's interesting. On the one hand, like I think I am, and I think my ancestors would be, you know, quite proud of just the things I've been able to do and the experiences I've been able to have. And, you know, it can be scary because you don't have anyone before you that's sort of done it or that's shown you how to do it and showing you that it's okay, sort of having that permission.
Yeah, I think that story resonates with me quite a bit as well in my journey. It took me a while to realize that experience I was having of like, I'm so lost. Like I can't quite figure out where my tenacity, my talents, my gifts fit with the outside world. But it took me a while to realize that that was supposed to be the case when you're the first who's trying to explore in a certain way. Mm-hmm. I certainly now don't blame anybody from my ancestry who didn't have the luxury of trying to explore being a creative or being an artist. I would never say that. But I also recognize why it can be very daunting and confusing and feel like you don't have any answers, because you are setting the answers for the future descendants. You're a living ancestor. So that was kind of a concept that came up when I was looking at ancestral veneration and honoring your ancestors, is also recognizing that your life is also a part of this tree and you're a living ancestor who can mm-hmm. determine what the future cycles and paths and blessings and challenges are going to be as well. For someone who's, you know, immigrated, and for someone who's like kind of immigrated again, you know, moving to New York in some ways mm-hmm. from Colorado, and then we'll be again coming up. I think about keep taking that with me wherever I go. You know, where I come from is not going to change no matter what decision or path I choose in the future. So mm-hmm. I finally now feel a little bit more settled in some ways, you know, in like, who am I, right? Mm-hmm. I do come from somewhere, but I also recognize I'm supposed to fill in some of the answers because I'm one of the ancestors.
Mm-hmm. That is such a beautiful reflection, and like being able to hold multiple truths, right? Like being able to hold that you are the first and you're sort of creating this path, and being able to hold that, you know, your ancestors didn't have the luxury or the privilege of being able to explore creativity, and like because of that, they maybe didn't equip you with what you needed, but still, you know, there's a lot that could be held in that same space of just like, yeah, I just sort of hear like the tenacity, the exploration, the everything that sort of can be growing out of the space, even if you didn't have the blueprint before.
Yeah, I think hopefully it takes some of the pressure off, even though I think some people hear this stuff and they're like, ooh, this is like responsibility. But really, it's like, the more I look at ancestral veneration and honoring our ancestors, the more I realize like we're all truly doing the best we can. Mm. And the reason some people didn't have the answers I needed was not necessarily out of malice, mm-hmm. but yeah, that's just been something that's helped, especially when you're someone who comes from like, you have a very multicultural life and you have, you know, traveled a lot in your life and things like that. I think it can be very helpful to like remind yourself that you have a very strong core of who you are and where you come from. So mm-hmm. I really enjoyed exploring that with you, especially around like themes of work and passion and things like mm-hmm. that, you know? Yeah.
Yeah, no, thanks for bringing it up. It is just such an interesting, and I'm like so thankful that I've had the opportunities and the experiences that I've had, and that I was able to, you know, that I chose to do things a little bit differently than had been sort of shown or that, you know, any of my ancestors had done. Because yeah, to your point about like living ancestors, like what will come of this? I mean, I have five nieces and a nephew. I have a little goddaughter who's 12. And so like, just even thinking about, you know, what it's like for them to know they have an aunt who lives in New York, and being able to show there are different ways of doing things and there are different approaches.
Mm-hmm. Different ways of being, for sure. Uh-huh. You know, you need that cool aunt or cool uncle sometimes. just to like expand your narratives around family sometimes, you know. It's given me a lot of gratitude, but also I think a lot of my like emotionality, the things that felt like difficult to express, were around this stuff, mm-hmm. you know, things that are kind of like a lot bigger than myself. So of course it can be overwhelming. And also, it doesn't always automatically fit or show up in like all the different compartments in our lives. You know, this is something that's almost bigger than that even. So I appreciate being able to like have a conversation around this with you. And I would bet there's some overlap between this and being able to work with people as a way of life, you know?
Mm-hmm. It's so interesting. And I'd need to think about it a bit more, but just yeah, that overlap of I'm really drawn to like being of service and what that means, and also reflective of the fact that I was raised in a culture that where women, you know, took care of the home and the family, and there was sort of that expectation. And so thinking about what I learned and how I want to be of service, but then like how I want that to look for me.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, and how I want to be of service and in a way that actually feels authentic to me and that isn't draining and, doesn't sort of overpower who I am.
Absolutely. I think in some ways that's kind of explains how we met, you know, meeting in a container where we got to explore these topics and how to be with ourselves while being with the other. It was a lot of that. And I guess looking back, I'm not surprised that themes around, you know, ancestry came up for the two of us in particular. I love meeting you in that space and kind of just seeing how you continue the work in, you know, in your corporate work and your work as a coach with clients and groups and things like that. So thank you for today. Yeah, I really appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you. It was such a fun conversation. I'm so glad that we were able to touch on a variety of topics that I find so interesting.
And before I forget, if people, in addition to your firm, but if people wanted to reach out to you for coaching or things like that, where can they find you?
Oh, absolutely. So my website is VanessaEsparza.com. So it's VanessaEsparza.com. I'm also on LinkedIn. My name's a long one. So my email is coaching@VanessaEsparza.com. But certainly LinkedIn is also an easy way to find me.
I'll make sure to hyperlink at least your business website in the show notes and everything, because I know how spelling can get you.
I know.
It's just like, oh, that's how you spelled it. That's why you didn't find me.
Yeah, exactly. Esparza tends to be a tough one for people sometimes.
Does that mean hope?
No, that's esperanza. Okay. But because it looks the same, I either get esperanza or I'll get, people will sometimes add an extra A in there somewhere.
Oh my God. I literally did that and I don't even know Spanish. I'm sorry. I literally did what you said.
No, it's common. So yeah, if you could hyperlink it, that would probably be easier.
Will do. Nothing like ending this conversation on a multi-culti situation that we're having right now.
Exactly.
But thank you for your time today, Vanessa.
Thank you so much.